In this video, we will review respiratory system medications for upper airway symptoms. To get a sense of how some of these medications work for upper airway symptoms, let's first look at the allergic response. An allergen is something that is recognized as foreign, and it creates a response from our body's defense system. Substances like pollen or food or mold, they can cause an allergic response. What happens is there's an exposure to an allergen and the body overreacts, causing antibodies called immunoglobulin E or IgE to be released. These antibodies bind to mast cells. Mast cells are a type of leukocyte or white blood cell. The allergen now binds to the antibody that's on the mast cell, which causes substances called mediators to be released. Some of these mediators are histamine, leukotrienes, prostaglandins, and tumor necrosis factor alpha. This is the body's way of trying to remove the thing you're allergic to, and it's these mediators that are responsible for allergic symptoms. So, does it make sense that medications would target this process and the chemical mediators to provide symptom relief? Mast cell stabilizers inhibit allergy cells or mast cells from bursting open and releasing those chemical mediators that cause inflammation and allergic symptoms. These medications are used primarily to prevent allergy-induced asthma. Cromolyn is an example and is most often given intranasal. Intranasal cromolyn can cause nasal burning and irritation. This medication is also available in oral form. Antihistamines block the action of the mediator histamine at the H1 receptor site, which is the receptor site responsible for allergic symptoms. These medications can give relief from sneezing and runny nose and are commonly over-the-counter medications. Diphenhydramine or Benadryl is an example of a first-generation antihistamine, and it's been around for a long time. There's a newer group of antihistamines, or second generation, which are more selective in how they impact the histamine receptors. This increased selectivity reduces adverse effects and sedation that are caused with these first generation drugs. I think it's really interesting that histamine plays a natural role in our bodies to keep us awake. So does it make sense that antihistamines would cause drowsiness? Antihistamine medications are also anticholinergic. Remember, anticholinergics dry everything up. So you're going to see dry eyes and blurred vision, constipation, urinary retention, and increased heart rate. Antitussives stop a cough by blocking the cough reflex in the central nervous system. These medications are used for a dry, non-productive cough. All of these medications cause drowsiness and dizziness and GI upset. Examples of opioid antitussives are codeine and hydrocodone. It's an important consideration that opioids, of course, they have a potential for abuse and they can cause respiratory depression. Non-opioid antitussives include dextromethorphan and benzonate. Dextromethorphan is similar chemically to opioids, so it acts on the central nervous system. It also has a risk for dependence and can cause respiratory depression. Benzonate is similar to a local anesthetic, tetracaine, and it numbs the stretch receptors in the lungs. If these medications are chewed, they can cause the mouth and the pharynx to be numb. Expectorants thin mucus and they make coughs more productive. These medications can help someone with chest congestion move the secretions out. A common expectorant is guaifenesin. Guaifenesin can be used alone or is often combined with antitussives, analgesics, or decongestants in cold and allergy medication preparations and have few side effects. Mucolytics directly loosen thick secretions. They do this by actually breaking down the chemical structure of the mucus molecule, which increases the ability to move secretions out. An example is acetylcysteine. When acetylcysteine is given by nebulizer, It can have a bad odor and may actually cause individuals to have nausea or even vomiting because of this odor. Because of this medication's effect on the mucous membranes, these medications can cause the adverse effect of bronchospasm. It's important to note that acetylcysteine is also used as an antidote for acetaminophen overdose. Decongestants constrict blood vessels and mucous membranes of the nose, which helps with nasal passage drainage. These medications are available as nasal sprays and oral medications. You will often see these medications also combined with other meds, other compounds like antihistamines and analgesics for cold and allergy symptoms. Examples of decongestants are phenylephrine and pseudoephedrine. These drugs can cause nervousness and are used with care with individuals with hypertension. Corticosteroids suppress the immune system, so by doing this, inflammation is decreased. Corticosteroids can be given IV, IM, PO, inhalation, or topically. Fluticasone is an example of a corticosteroid for upper airway symptoms. Notice the O-N-E ending for these generic drugs. Almost all the corticosteroids end in O-N-E. Fluticasone can be given intranasal to help with allergic rhinitis, which is symptoms that affect the nose, by decreasing inflammation in the nasal passages. Fluticasone is also available as an inhaler to decrease bronchial inflammation for those with asthma or COPD. It's important to note that these medications have the potential for systemic corticosteroid adverse effects like adrenal insufficiency. Because of the immune suppressant, corticosteroids can mask symptoms of infection. A couple important notes on corticosteroid inhalers. We have to make sure that we assess individuals for thrush, which is a fungal infection in the mouth. Thrush appears like white patches that can be in the roof of the mouth and on the tongue. When using corticosteroid inhalers, individuals must rinse their mouth out with water after use. If using these inhalers in combination with bronchodilator inhalers, the bronchodilator is used first to open up the airway. Then we need to wait for 5 minutes and then use the corticosteroid inhaler. Lastly, note that these aren't rescue inhalers. Corticosteroids are used routinely for prevention. Well, that's it for respiratory medications that help with upper airway symptoms. If you have any questions, let me know.